本当に喋ってやってるのか。ああ
Thank you, Toshina. So, as we gather here tonight for this prayer service, I wanted to let you know that there was also a simultaneous prayer memorial service happening in Dharamsala, India, on the same day. There was a memorial for last night, actually, in Delhi at the JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University, by a group of Tibetan students. And I think yeah, we have all seen over the last couple of days the outpouring of grief and mourning for Elliot on the internet, over social media, all over the world. And all of that, I think we all know, is a sign of the impact, this incredible impact that Elliot had on every single person that he met. On every one of us, and many of us here tonight are here as very dear, close friends of Elliot. Some of us are here as students of Elliot and former students, and many of us may be here also because we are just, you know, admirers of Elliot, that we read his work and that we appreciate the difference that he made in the world, the difference that he made for justice, for human rights. And among all the friends who are here, I think one of the oldest friends of Elliot, somebody who has known Elliot for more than 30-some years, since the 1970s, Ruan, is Jana Bula here. Jamila has been a friend of Elliot, as a fellow writer, fellow scholar, fellow academic, and fellow activist. So I'll ask Jayla to say a few words and help us remember Elliot.
I just want to thank the members of the Sangha for coming up tonight for this very vigil, and I want to thank all of you for turning up on a school night. Maybe I don't need to do that, all of you came in some way, because Elliot touched you in one way or the other in your heart. You know, I really can't say all that much tonight. You know, I don't want to sort of get too emotional or anything. I just want to tell you something simple about his relationship with me. You know, like on his academic side, on the contributions he's made to Tibetan service. I think Tendola this morning, we had a radio discussion about Voice of America, and he put it really well. I think I'll leave it to him to do that. I just want to tell you about my personal friendship. I met him, it was 1970. You know, he was just a young, skinny kid from Queens, in an oversized kind of red down jacket, rather faded, in Dharamsala. And he was practicing his Tibetan there. And we got to know each other not because of Tibetan studies. I wasn't really into that. And, you know, I'm not an academic, I was never into academia. And Elliot was, but we got together because of politics. I was writing in the Tibetan Review, and he liked my writings. And he was one of the first persons there to encourage people from the West to encourage me in my writing. And he liked the fact that I wrote, when I talked of China, when I talked of all the problems he had, I always quoted a lot from George Orwell. And Elliot, I admired George Orwell tremendously. And I quoted not only from his well-known works, but from his lesser works. And I think that Elliot impressed Elliot in no end. And you know, also the fact that I quoted from Russian writers and poets, Gustav Mandelstam, Solzhenitsyn. He was really pleased to find a Tibetan doing that. And he expected to find a much more kind of traditional Tibetan world in Dharamsala. And from then on, we got together, became great buddies, not only friends, but comrades in arms, you know, for the Tibetan struggle. And he always saw the Tibetan struggle in the way, you know, like I saw it, as a great group. It's a global struggle, the struggle that people had against Stalin, against Mao, and this struggle continues even now with us. Whatever people may say about the situation of Tibet, it is the same oppression and tyranny that people face there that Elie always stood up against. But when he first came to Dharamsala, you know, he was just starting in his studies of Tibet. And to practice his Tibetan, he would go into the little chan shops, you know, where they sold Tibetan beer, and talk with all the old Tibetans there. He didn't like the fact that Tashi and I, you know, his other friend Tashi Singh and I went sometimes, but we couldn't afford it to the Hotel Tibetan Grand Beer. You know, he was very careful with his money because, you know, it had to last him for a long time. You know, he wasn't a rich man at all. So he went to the chan shop and we drank beer on the side. And of course, he got his first bout of hepatitis, I think it was, and he nearly died in, you know, in his youth. But he got over it. And then later he studies Tibetan. This Tibetan, his knowledge of Tibetan, of the texts, the scriptures, is tremendous. His spoken Tibetan is a very kind of New York, speedy Tibetan. A lot of Tibetans find difficulty sometimes deciphering. But then he began to study Chinese, classical Chinese. And that's what I think made him this, you know, very rare scholar who knew not only the languages, but the classical languages. In Dharamsala, then, you know, I won't go into this, but I just want to tell you that off and on, he would always come to Dharamsala. And you know, when it was wonderful to always meet him. But one day, you know, he got the MacArthur Genius Award and lots of money in it. And he rushed to Dharamsala, he came there. You know, and he went to the Library of Tibetan Works and Archives where he did his research and study, and he made a huge contribution there. Then he came to Tibet, because I was the director of Tibet at the time, and he gave me a big contribution for the institute. And then he called all his Tibetan friends, all of us, to Hotel Tibet to drink up. You know, he said, tonight I am a rich American capitalist. You know, what you call, I think, you know, that's a communist way of saying it. And he said, you are capturing a bango, you know, you're like refugee. So drink up, you know. And ever since then, he's always bought the drinks. So, you know, he was very generous. And not only, let's see, you know, I'm just bringing up the drinks, because I remember that, but the fact that I had a lot of problems being a writer and being an intellectual in India because books are hard to come by. The books I need, the specialty were books. And you know, like, I only knew the New York Review of Books sometimes, you know, like one or two copies a year someone would send me. And Elie took it upon himself to mail me expensive books that I needed, he knew I needed for my writing. And also the New York regular subscription of the New York Review of Books. I was the only person in Dharamsala, in probably the whole of Himachal Pradesh, who had a subscription to that. So it was for these reasons that, you know, we really bonded. You know, whatever political sort of effort I started, he was always there to support me. The most recent being the Tibetan National Congress. One organization that stands firmly for Tibetan independence. And Elie immediately wanted to be a life member. You know, he wanted also to be one of the first. So it's like in the old days, you know, if you joined the Communist Party, if you had a single digit number, it meant you weren't really senior member, echelon. So Elie wanted a single digit number for his TNC membership. Because he said, you never know, the Communist Party of China started in Shanghai, only about 11 or 12 people. and Mao was one, but he was a junior. You know, and they're two Dutch observers. And the first meeting was in a girl's, in the dormitory of a girl's school in Shanghai. You know, and nobody knew, it was a joke. But look at what became. But of course, if you take it on the positive side, he said that the TNC, of course, there is always a hope that we can do something together. So if you look at the Wikipedia page, you know, he's mentioned in his page, you'll notice that he's wearing the Tibetan National Congress, you know, our symbol, which is the sword of Manjushri. You know, the sword, the burning sword that cuts through the chains of ignorance, apathy, and fear, liberating all beings. So that's what we are aspiring to do. And Elliot is always there for us in terms of friendship, you know, generous contributions. But one thing, you know, that was special about him was he never wanted to be, even suggestions, you know, that he should be part of the leadership. No. He said the struggle belongs to the Tibetans. The Tibetans have to carry out. He is a strong supporter and a passionate one and a very argumentative one. You know, whenever we do something, he always had to find some, you know, fault in what you're doing and let us know it. But he always said Tibetans have to do that themselves. So I just want to, I'm not going to carry on. I think I can go on all night. There are other people who have memories to contribute. But I just want to say one thing, because on this question of what that Tibetans have to do it themselves, Elliot felt that Tibetans, young Tibetans, must learn Tibetan history. And that was his standard for Meitei. He was a great expert. And many Tibetan students, you know, in India, Delhi University, JNUS, there are a lot of brothers that are here, know him, they've listened to his lecture. Even in Tibet, in Beijing University, he spoke to many young Tibetans there. And he was careful not to say anything that splitters might get them into trouble. But, you know, he made them feel excited about their history and their culture. But he always, this was, a talk he gave, this brief talk he gave in Delhi, when the Tibetan government invited Western historians from Tibet for a conference. And at that conference, Goldenis was there and some of the Tibetan leadership from Dharamsala to Kashan and all of there. And I think after they spoke, they wanted some representative from the Western historians themselves. And Elliot, being the senior most, I guess they asked him to speak. And he gave a wonderful speech, but he concluded by telling the Tibetan audience, but there are a lot of young kids from Delhi University and JNU in the audience. And he said, look, whatever the meeting here is about with us Western historians of Tibet, for us, this is a job. It's a career. And we sort of earn our bread and butter through this. Of course, we get passionate about it, but it's not ours. It belongs to Tibetans. He said, furthermore, it doesn't belong to the Kashyap. Not just to official group, or even to His Holiness. He said, it belongs to the Tibetan people, especially the young, because they are the ones who have the future, who can do something about it. So it's important for the young to learn their history, to remember what happened in Tibet, never forget it. And on that note, you know, even His Holiness later, some people are upset because it sounded a bit disrespectful to the government and His Holiness, but His Holiness totally agreed. He said, you're absolutely right. And that is something, you know, Elliot, you always expect him to say something that sounds a little controversial, you know, problematic sometimes. But if you think about it, he was always right. He was true to himself. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chandler. I want to mention that we have Elliot's daughter, Colleen, with us tonight here. Colleen.
Can't thank you enough for the amount of outreach and outpour over the last few days. As I'm sure you know, this is completely unexpected. interesting, my dad transitioned over the last few years from being a father to a close friend and a confidant, and I know he was that for many of you as well. He spoke. Many of you are like aunts and uncles. I grew up with you, remember seeing you as a kid. It's almost like you're raising it. But he still spoke so often of you, dinners with his former students. He reminisced about the gang over in Dharamsala, Peter Brown, and the likes. I know as much as you touched his life, I can tell by the amount of support, for compassion, sympathy, the emails, messages, just the outreach, that as much as you touched his life, he had a great impact on yours as well. He had just retired. He finally finished his move to Jackson Heights, back to the homeland. He was happy to be away from Indiana. He just finished a stint in Vienna where he taught, he traveled, he met up with former friends. He was almost filled with it. Excitement. He was more full of life than I had seen him in a very long time. I saw him in December, just about a month ago, and he was just ready to embark on this next journey. He was excited. As we were mourning today, he had a life that was so fully lived. He had so much accomplishment. Such a great impact, and please do not forget to celebrate his life as well, because one which was lived like that should certainly be celebrated.
So this event tonight is actually organized by a few different organizations. And lead organizing role has been taken by Tibet National Congress, TNC, with help and support from US Tibet Committee, Students for a Free Tibet, and Tibet House. So I want to thank all these organizations for putting this event together. And now TNC has a statement that Dobal Lhamo will read. And after that, we have a few more people who will share and contribute memories.
Good evening. It's a statement from the Tibet National Congress. In Tibet's recent tragic history and subsequent upheaval and displacement, it was fortunate enough to find well-wishers and friends who helped ease the anguish and bewilderment of losing one's country and transitioning into a refugee life. There were few who not only wanted to help this fragile community, but wanted to understand and sustain its enduring legacy and did everything they could towards that end. And some within this small group studied Tibet's history, language, cultural, etc., and became expert in their own right and championed Tibet cause as their own. Professor Elliot Spalding was one such region that the Tibetan world was fortunate enough to count as one of its dearest friends and mentor. He was one of the foremost experts on Tibet and Tibet-China relations and have authored many scholarly papers and written numerous articles regarding the subject matter. His passionate advocacy for Tibetan independence and his steadfast loyalty to Tibetan people and nation is unsurpassable. He was highly respected and regarded for his fierce, indomitable, and relentless voice for Tibet and human rights. One such example was the instrumental role he played in the formation of Tibetan National Congress. From the very start, as was his style and conviction, he insisted that he will only take an advisory role. He wisely and pragmatically dramatically exposed the idea that the Tibetan national independence struggle must be led and sustained by Tibetans themselves, while he himself will avail all his expertise and resources at call upon and become lifetime sustaining member. True to his word, Professor Spalding never failed to provide his invaluable advice and counsel to the fledgling organization and helped build the foundation. In fact, TNC's very first meeting was held in his New York apartment, and his unbounded enthusiasm and infectious energy was highly inspiring for all those who were there. If I may be audacious to say that one of his last legacy and living testimony will be the formation of Tibetan National Congress. To the very last, his conviction that Tibetan cultural and language and history can only be safeguarded by a free and independent Tibet remained unshaken. His passing has been a tremendous loss to Tibet and Tibetan people. He will be deeply missed, and his great contribution to our cause forever cherished and unshrink in our memories. Farewell, dear Professor. Rest in power, President Jimmy Wooten. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to call up Sona Mongdula, who is the head of U.S. Tibet Committee. And the U.S. Tibet Committee is actually the oldest Tibet support group in the United States, probably in North America, actually. And Sona Mongdula is legitimately the first or the oldest Tibetan activist in North America. Sona Mongdula, please.
Thank you very much. I knew not earlier, like in the 70s, probably after Jamala had met him in Dharamsala. I think he had finished his PhD at Indiana University and came to New York and was trying to look for a job. At the same time, he was working with the Office of Tibet to help set up a center that it could establish some kind of a library. And he was working there. And eventually, I think he got an offer to go and teach at the Southern University of Mississippi. And that's when I think he got the MacArthur Award for genius. And of course, after that, universities were eager to have him on their faculty. But Elliot returned back to Indiana University, where he was working with Thapar Mutchie, His Holiness Dalai Lama's elder brother. I remember Elliot, very passionate, didn't mince words, spoke very frankly. Sometimes his frankness may have touched some people, but I think the purity of his heart, compassion of his heart, is impeccable. And as we, Jamyang had said, and Tandola, his impact on the Tibetan younger generation is what the legacy is. His legacy will live through those people. So this time, I think, we are very blessed to have had his counsel. We will always remember him with gratitude. And the effort to keep his spirit with us all times. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We'll ask Tsenen Langyala to say a couple words in Tibetan, actually. Tsenen Langyala is the president of Tibetan National Congress.
대진하게 남쪽으로 가도다 점점 다다 지하지기 칸이 열어. 때문에 다리 가도 좀 다다 지하대 조고 야보지. 근데 니나는 미세도야 지지미지 아주 표정이 돌아야 사무실 우주주고 땅등에 내 마음과 배들어야 내가 강하게 말해 내 대지 레트를 좋아지니 내 대지 조고지 아주 다 다니 더블이 비블이 만들 아주 더 잘했어 말해 내 대로 보면 이제 내 대지 레 얘나야 난 말하기 좋아서는 충분히 지시해요 가장 나와 찍으니까 코가 많이 두면 깨지시해 그래서 내 링크지 지하 차시 그랬다 내 책에 대한 게 많이 코로나 때도 링크지 그런 게 코로나 때 힘들어 때리지니 코로나기 저는 리뷰도 지시로 야구도 예초로 잡죠 같이도 지고 오신 드니 프로그램 시에서 하나 빼 넣어줘 빼나 말 리뷰도 단단하지나 자나 대표열에 프로그램 한두 번 잡을 남겨요 드나 시수나 오돌아 남겨요 그래도 참아만을 로바치다 그래 또 원래 애를 비치고 나든 하비 세바 양을 지켜와 가야지 원래 미 양을 막 다들 로바 넣었으면 왜 다니 난 다음에 재미 차원 이나 양 얘기 고마워 두드치고 리뷰 되게 미투니 미투니 막 좋아하니 이제 막 미투니 내가 지향이 이제 완전 조금 참아야지 그런 마음보다 재와 약 유연지 완전 배워 참아야지 그런 마음보다야야 재도 미재워내야 미조 미강이 되게 남다라 높아지 동해 미스님 삼보지 재워내야 문제 시야이 네가 되는 시야이
Thank you. We have a couple of people still lined up, but I know that we have also a lot of former students. Of Elliot as well, and some other very close friends that we don't know personally. So if anybody wants to say a couple of words now, please feel free to just come up here and treat this like an open mic. Okay? I'll give it a couple of seconds. Okay. Would you like to come up? Yeah, please. Yeah. We might have more people contributing stories and memories, so if possible, we'll try to limit our comments to a couple of minutes, give or take. Thank you.
My name is Yang Shui. I'm a Chinese activist living in Washington, D.C. I met Elliot. I started having email exchanges with Elliot at the beginning of 2015. At the time, I was our website ChinaChange.org. I was thinking about translating the Uyghur scholar Yoham Toti's work, and from there do some advocacy work. So I know. He was a friend of Yoham Toti. They met in Beijing a couple times. They became very good friends. And I also knew he was taking care of Johar Yoham right there. And so I was reaching out to Elliot to ask what we could do together. And then I first met him in the summer of 2015 on Columbia Heights near there in the Prada, the restaurant with Johar. And I told Elliot, I said, I have been working on the nomination of Yoham Toti for the Sakharov Prize. I'm heading to Brussels. And he's like, I'm going with you. At the time, I have the sense that he's probably thinking, who is this middle-aged Chinese woman? I better go and make sure she doesn't mess up things. That's the sense I get. He didn't know, and I didn't say that, oh my God, I am scared to death to make this trip, but however I must make. And I was so glad that he offered himself to go. I was like, I was literally grabbed his arm. I said, please come, I'm scared. And so he came on his at his own expenses. From there on, we together made several trips to Strasbourg, Brussels, and I'm very happy to have to report that in September 23rd, 2016, Johann Totti was nominated for the Sakharov Prize. It was tremendous work because we are all grassroots. Now, Elliot might be professor, but in terms of activists, we don't have political connections. It's all grassroots from ground up. We don't know anybody. By sheer will that we want this for Johann Totti, so we went through this. Since we were on several trips, you grow closer to people on these occasions. I shared a meal with Elliot. I drank champagne with Elliot. I exchanged emails with him on a very, very regular basis. Just hard to believe. And I feel like the last few days, I feel like somebody took a leg and an arm off me. And this is not just a metaphor. The Johann Totti campaign has been taking the arm and leg off. And I don't know what to say. Oh, we'll all have to keep going. In all my little conversations, we have never touched on something metaphysical, but today, I hope he had heard all of us. Thank you.
Library, and I've seen him twice since the beginning of the year. The first time, to my surprise, he was standing next to me at a pen demonstration on the steps of the main branch of the New York City Public Library. He asked to look at my sign, on which was a quote from George Orwell. And then after a while, he left and I stayed, and he emailed me that he'd been thinking curmudgeonly thoughts. And he gave me a critique of one of the speakers, which I did agree with when I heard it. After that, we arranged to have a coffee, and on January the 24th, we met for about 2 hours at a little Italian cafe on Bleecker near Carmine, and he was full of life. We talked about many things, and then he went off to have a swim.
Thank you. I want everybody to know that, you know, Ilham Tohti, the renowned Uyghur intellectual who is now serving a life sentence in Chinese prison, everybody knows him. And Ilham Tohti's daughter is here with us tonight, Jawahar Tohti, Jawahar Ilham. And, you know, Elliot has been actually helping Ilham and actually taking care of Jawahar as an uncle or almost like a father in recent years. So Jawahar will share a couple of words with us.
Hello, everyone. This probably is my first speech or talk without Elliot's helping me. First time I met him was the first day I arrived in the U.S. He picked me up from the airport. I didn't speak any English at that time. I didn't know who this person was. I just had the name card my dad gave me. Like, if anything happened, contact him. Elliot had only met my father twice before he met, once actually, before he met me. But he said, okay, I admire your father, so I'm willing to take care of him. He didn't say that, but he actually did it. He was like my teacher. He was like my best friend. He was like a father to me and an uncle. I always call him Elliot Shushu. And then he's like, oh, Junior. It's like, oh, my little niece or something like that in Chinese. He taught me English. He taught me how to use laundry. And I never ate anything raw when I was in China. He taught me how to eat salad. He told me it's healthy. You have to eat it. You will live longer. And then he told me you should read a lot of books. You should be knowledgeable. You should know more things than you can help other people. He was like a family to me. He is my family. All my family members knew him, and he knew every single person in my family, families too. The last time I met him, it was actually January 17th. I had a conference at UN. I stayed a night at his apartment, and the second day morning, I was supposed to leave the second day morning to the conference and then leave directly to the airport. And then he told me, okay, I'll have to walk you to UN. I told him, I'm already 22 years old, I have GPS, I can't go by myself. He said, no, I'm your shushu. I have to take the responsibility, I have to take care of you. What if you're lost in the big city? I'm like, no, this is my 10th time in New York, I don't need. And then that was the last time we walked together. He woke up at 7:30 in the morning, prepared salad, and walked me to UN together. Oh, he always forced me to drink coffee with him. I didn't like that at all. I remember, sorry for like saying sometimes for about things 4 years ago, sometimes like about present stuff. I'm just, everything is coming, like a movie coming to my brain right now, coming to my mind. After I left from New York, actually the day when I stayed in New York, we had this talk about, I asked him, why do you travel so much? Don't spend all your money. Leave it to Colleen. I told him like this. He said, I have so much money from the retirement money. And then I asked him, how long time will they pay you? He told me, 5 more years. I said, 5 more years? Why? Why? Is Indiana University crazy? Do they think you will only live 5 more years? Why do they only pay you 5 more years? They should pay you 300 more years. And then he laughed. And I'm like, it's okay, I have saved a lot. And then I told him, I don't know why at that time I felt really sad. And then I asked him to promise me, Elliot, You should live 300 more years, and you should take care of and educate my grandchildren like how you educated me. He said, okay, I will do that. He laughed and smiled and told me, okay, I promise. And then after a week, I texted him. He didn't reply. I thought, did I do something wrong? Made him mad? And then I texted him again. And he didn't reply either. I had like really nervous feeling like, oh, what is going on? Why is he not replying? So I texted him again, oh, is everything okay? And that was last Friday. One of the IU professors invited me to her house for dinner. And then when I took Uber to her house, and I copy and paste her address to the Uber, the address place. But somehow I mistyped and I typed Ella's previous house address. And somehow on Friday, I went to his house with Uber. And then when I got there, I went, oh, I think I must type in the wrong address. And then I just changed my destination. I didn't think too much at that time. And then I went to that professor's home. And then 2 days ago when I met that professor, we brought this topic again. And then she told me, do you remember on Friday, you went to Ella's house accidentally? I don't know what this means, but maybe Ella wanted to let me know. I don't know. He's a very, very important, very, very important person to my family, to me, and Colleen too. I only met Colleen a few times, but I heard about her many, many, many times. Ellie was so proud of her. Oh, my daughter is very beautiful. She's very smart. She has a great job. I think she inherited a lot of things from me because I'm very intelligent and handsome. That's what he always said. And maybe many of you know what kind of personality he has. I hope people here today, please don't forget him. He's a, can I say treasure? Treasure? Yeah. For the society, for this world, for everyone. For me, he's the best person in the world. I never met such a kind person like him. I consider myself as kind, but not even 1%. He says mean things, but he has the best heart. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I quickly want to acknowledge we have representatives from two very important organizations here with us. One is Tibetan Youth Congress, the Regional Tibetan Youth Congress. Leaders are here. And also the National Chushikandruk leaders are here as well. So for those of you who may not know, Chushikandruk is the guerrilla Tibetan resistance from the 1950s and 60s. They were basically, you know, the first organization or voluntary force that fought Chinese invasion. So the leadership of Chushikandruk is here as well to pay their respects to Elliot. Now, I think last speaker, representative leader of Students for a Free Tibet, is Pema Yoko, the acting director of SFT.
Thank you. My condolences to the family and yeah. So on behalf of Students for a Free Tibet, I think I'm probably our organization is the youth. And my first experience with Elliot was actually at one of the Lhagra Academy trainings where I think around 16 young Tibetans from across the world went to Dharamsala to learn about our history, about China. It was a 1 week sort of training, intense, one month intense from morning to night. And that was my first engagement with Ellis Berlin. I think it was only 6 or 7 years ago. And, you know, yes, Elliot was the guy, he was a mentor to us the youth, you know, especially particularly about our history. He's always, and then when I moved to New York, sometimes I'd find myself hiding away from him because he's always like, have you done this? Have you read this? Are you doing this? Why are you doing this? What is SFT doing? And so, you know, he was like, there was so much passion in him, right? So much drive, which, you know, when I found out the news, those were the things that I thought of, you know, that, you know, we have this event coming up next week, February 13th, Tibetan Independence Day. And I was like, we have to do this for Elliot, you know? We have to do this bigger and better, because that was his message. And that is what inspired me on that day when I heard his news, that we have to, you know, do more, we have to learn our history and, you know, work together for Tibet. And that was his message at the end of the day from Elliot. And, you know, at SFT, we will always cherish that, to remember our history in order to shape our future for a free Tibet. So, thank you.
Okay, so thank you so much to everyone who shared memories. And I just wanted to add one really quick thing from a slightly different angle as a student, not as a direct student taking a class with Elliot, but as a student of Elliot still, because all of us, we learned so much from him in so many conversations, especially over the last 2 years being in New York after Elliot moved to Jackson Heights. I think he purposely had to move to Jackson Heights because that's where all the Tibetans and Indians are living. But yeah, over the last 2 years, having so many occasions, conversations, every conversation with Elliot was like a class, pretty much. You know, you just learned so much. And for me in particular, I think about a year ago, I was in school doing my master's, and I took a class on the history of China-Tibet relations. And it was a class with Professor Guaita. Actually, some of our classmates are here as well. Over the course of the semester, the class covered maybe 700 years of history, starting from the Mongol Yuan dynasty and their relationship with Tibet, and then Chinese Ming dynasty and their relationship with the Tibetans, and then finally the Manchu Qing dynasty. And, you know, 80% of the reading material that we had, papers, books, almost 80% of everything we read for that class was either written by Elliot or they were based on Elliot's work. There were citations, heavily citations of Elliot's work. And that was, by that time, I had already known Elliot for about a year, sort of personally. Until that moment, I had not, you know, like everybody knew Elliot was this really incredible scholar and amazing historian in that sense. But for me, that was when I got this visible, you know, real feeling, a realization of how important he was for our history and what an impact he had. Because it was almost like he gave us back, for Tibetans, he gave us back 700 years of our history, you know. Up until that moment, we didn't know. Everything was either missing or scattered. And one thing that's worth remembering is also, you know, until Elliot came along, especially in the academic world of historians, what I've heard is, you know, among many scholars who looked at Tibet and Tibet's relationship with China over those 600-700 years. A lot of people went through Chinese materials and Chinese sources, and many of those sources would often be incomplete or biased, or somehow people understood Tibet through Chinese sources and through Chinese eyes in that sense for so many academics. But after Elliot came along and the work that he did, the research that he did by looking at Chinese sources as well as Tibetan sources, after that everything changed. You know, the debate changed, the discourse changed, and suddenly there was a new narrative that was a more accurate capture of Tibetan history and Tibet's relationship with the Manchus, the Ming, and the Mongols. So I think the kind of impact Elliot had in that sense is really priceless, incredible, and that's, I think, part of the reason why Elliot was really driven by history, and he really emphasized how Tibetans should learn our history, how Tibetans should pay more attention to our history. And I think over the last couple of years, you would have noticed online the theme, you know, so many people expressing their grief at Elliot's passing. And one of the recurring themes that have been coming up is basically what somebody said, with Elliot gone, it's as if a whole library had burned down. And I think that's very true. You know, but in a way, even more important than that, I think, for me in particular, I think it's Elliot as the human being. I think as a really unique, incredibly kind, compassionate, and fearless human being, that is what we're going to miss the most. But I think, as Colleen said, it's also very important for us to celebrate Elliot's work and his life, and what did he work for in his life, and the things that were important to him. I think those are all the things that we can continue to keep working on. So please, I think everybody can keep, as we remember Elliot and think of Elliot, and I'm sure he's here with us right now, because Elliot showed up to every single event. He came to every single event, whether it was in front of the Chinese consulate, or in front of the UN, or at Tibet House. He loved coming to Tibet House. He loved coming here and debating with Bob Thurman. He loved coming here and, you know, basically engaging with people and giving people what he knew, giving people his knowledge. He just gave so generously of everything, his knowledge. And like Jayala said, he always bought the drinks. He always, you know, was super kind and generous with everything. So let's all remember that. And I think the best way we can pay Elliot back is by working on the things that he held as really important. So Jayala, you want to conclude, right?
I just wanted to make a request to all Elliot's friends and admirers and supporters here. The reason why he came and settled in Jackson Heights was, you know, that's not the place really one retires. You know, it's not Florida, it's not Palm Beach. But he wanted to come here because the Tibetans were here. And he wanted to do something with the young Tibetans. And we worked on this together. I bought an apartment in Jackson Heights. You know, he bought me, you know, like, I can't, you know, Olin is not big, so Elliot doesn't have to worry about her. But my daughter's still 13, I said, I'm coming. And we would work on various projects to encourage younger Tibetans to read their history, to understand it. You know, and maybe publish works together and set up some sort. You know, it was just very perfunctory. So, you know, like, we were going to do more. And I was going to come down and, you know, it's all going to be wonderful. But, you know, to paraphrase, you know, man proposes, you know, and karma disposes. But nonetheless, you know, I'm so glad that all of you, you know, feel strongly about him. And I really need some support so that we can carry on some. Main thing is the work. For him, it was the most important thing. The work for educating Tibet. You and for promoting the Tibetan struggle. And so in order to do something, we haven't worked out anything yet, and I'm not in any position to even think about it. But something will happen, and I will approach all our friends here, you know, publicizing, and at that time I hope you will all be able to make your contribution somehow to preserve Elliot's memory in the best way, through work, through activism. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And thank you once again to all the organizers, and thank you everyone for being here. Thank you, Tushana. Thank you for the prayers, Tushana. Tushana.
Jeda